All right, I'm back with Speeda Demon and his Nitro Rocket powered motorbike. That's the official name of it. If you haven't seen the parts video, check that out. You can see all the individual parts. If you haven't seen the speed build videos, check those out. They're not too long because they are speed build videos. They skip all of the uninteresting stuff and just show you the assembly as quickly as possible. This is what you get once you've assembled everything together. We'll go ahead and let you see the combination of the two from a few different angles here. Let me see how that ended up working out. They call this motorbike, like I said, a Nitro Rocket powered unit, and it has electric exhaust or lightning exhaust. So it actually has ionized gas that it lets out of its turbine-like engines. I guess they're not really rockets, they're more like jets. I don't know exactly what the technology is behind it, but they did end up looking pretty cool on this bike. It's got the little spinning little compressors up at the front. They used a little bit of Hero Factory influence here to put these shield pieces or guards around the engine pieces. This is what it looks like all together, but I'm going to take these apart and actually look at them individually. And so you can see how, first of all, how he's connected to the bike. His hands do connect on directly onto the handlebars, and the handlebars can turn side to side pretty nicely. It's got a steep rake to the front forks, but it looks pretty cool. And then the funny thing right here is he's pretty securely attached to the bike. You know, even with his hands not on there, he's not going to fall off. It's because his butt is snapped into the seat. It's actually clicked in like that. That's kind of funny, but it's effective though in the Lego world. It's not something that you would do in real life, I don't think, unless you have a really weird shaped butt, but that's how they do it here. And I think it's actually a good idea for just the connection method, because as I showed you, it really holds on pretty well. But here we go. Speeda Demon taking off. I'm gonna put him aside for a second and just focus on the bike for a minute if I can. Now, the assembly of it worked out really well. The instructions are done very well. The order of building things together seems kind of weird at some points, but it all works out. I didn't have any real stumbling blocks along the way. Everything went together pretty smoothly. It has a nice consistent color scheme throughout. You know, it's got the purple that's taken from front to back. Not a whole lot of purple pieces on there, but just enough. And I think that works out pretty well. It's got a little bit of headlight detail up here that's pretty nice. I like this little cowling piece here and the little fender part back there. That works out really well. It's got these supposedly razor sharp blades on the wheels, so he can, you know, go kind of crash side by side with other vehicles and possibly pop their tires out. I like that these little blades actually spin. I really like that the handlebars work out well. It's covered well in here. There's nice detail in here. It's actually interesting that the way that they hook this up with this kind of claw piece here that just keeps these little surge weapons that become electrified exhaust from moving around, because it's just an axle that goes through a pinhole. So it's just that's keeping it in there. I don't like this so much though. This looked a little unfinished, a little lazy. If I were to do a revamp on this bike, I would definitely focus most of my attention just on this area, just filling it up, adding some other detail to it to not leave the Technic lift arms just sitting out there kind of raw as they are right now. The bike is really long, it's really narrow, which just makes it look very, very, very sleek and kind of futuristic. But this part in here is just too skeletal in the wrong way with the holes going through there. I think it's the holes that really kill it. I think it looks okay from like this, like if you go from a distance a little bit and having that space in there, I think that works out all right. But just the holes, something needs to be done about that. But all in all, pretty happy with the bike, and can kind of stand on its own, you know, over to one side. It doesn't have kickstands on it, but it does hold up on its own. So if you're doing something with the figure of the Speed of Demon figure, you can just still have this kind of standing up like that. So that works out pretty well. All in all, pretty happy with the bike. Not 100%, but pretty much. And then moving over to the Speeda Demon figure himself. So here he is. These little electrical sparklers that are coming off here are actually in the Lego description. They're described as lightning handlebars. It's supposed to be actually shock coming out of the bike, but the way that he comes off, it ends up actually attaching to him. And in the instruction process, or in the instructions, in the assembly process, they actually have you attach these to him separately. It's not included as part of attaching him to the bike or anything. So I don't know. It is what it is. This is something that I'm really, 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 really happy about. He has two extra arms on the back. Now that sounds weird. It kind of looks weird, but here's the thing, they've broken away from the purely humanoid form here, which is great. That's something they definitely need to do more and more of, because, you know, these are robots. You know, they're mechanical things. They're not based on human DNA, so they don't need to have just two legs and two arms and a head in the middle and two eyes and all that. They can do stuff like this, and it makes perfect sense. So here, Speeda Demon, you know, his hands, maybe you can think of his hands having little outputs at the ends, or something that he's just holding on to that internally has some circuitry and it's able to let out sparks, so he can kind of use those for melee attacks. But then he's also got these on the back, and these long blades, they call them wing blades, they can be used for many different things. First of all, he can kind of use them for attacking in the front, because look at that, it can actually come all the way forward, and there's a lot of articulation to this because it can rotate this way, and there's a second joint there, and there's a hand on it, so you know it can move in all sorts of different ways. He can use it defensively, so when he's being chased, whether he's on foot or on his bike, he can be using these back here, just kind of turn his head around and have a look out the corner of his eye, and he can actually fight backwards while he's going this way. So that's really cool. And then also, they call them wing blades, I think because of the way that they look, but that description just, or the name of it just got me thinking that when he's on his bike, he can kind of use these like wings as like stabilizers, you know, aerodynamic stabilizers. So if his bike is leaning over too much to one side, and you know, maybe he's kind of on the side of a hill and it's having a little bit of trouble keeping it upright and not turning, he can actually use the blades as wings or as winglets and just aerodynamic devices to help stabilize him, or maybe even to help him to turn faster, or he can turn them all the way up like this or in like this and use them as kind of like an air brake, you know, actually have the maximum drag there. So that's really cool. And maybe when he's going extra fast, he can just kind of tight, you know, pull them in. Let's see, there we go. Just pull them in like this so that they're facing back, and then he has the minimum amount of drag because the air just kind of goes right by his head like that. So there's a lot of stuff that can be done with these. You can look at them different ways, you can think of them different ways, you can pose them different ways. I'm very happy that they put these on there. As far as the rest of the figure, he's a little skinny, you know, he doesn't have a lot of bulk to him. This doesn't feel so good to me personally, just the upper legs. I love this type of armor, but against the black and long upper legs, didn't work out so well for me. I think I would have preferred use of gray here at least, and then something to fill up those holes, because when you see them from the front, the holes kind of stick out to me. You don't see anything else here when you're just looking at them that looks like holes. His upper body is a little bit thin, but I think that's okay. I think that kind of works with his overall proportions. All right, from the sides, still looks good, as a lot of the armor is attached on from the side, so that works out well. And then from the back, they did one thing to help cover up the back, because without this piece right here, it would look really empty and open, and I think that just again making, as they've done on all of the sets so far that I've seen from Breakout Wave 2, just making a small effort to cover up the back is a big step in the right direction for Lego. The earlier figures were always looking pretty poor from the back, even when they looked really good from the front. So I think this is good. Could have a little bit more covering right here. And again, from the back, just the same problem for me visually with the holes in the legs. But of course, you could swap these out. You could put different armor, different types of armor here. If you have other figures, you can combine different pieces together. And there's lots of stuff that you can do, to kind of tweak the look of them. The neck has a lot of articulation because of the way that they do the villains with the head kind of forward like that. And it's supposed to make them look more villainous, but it also gives them a lot more ability to look around and just be more expressive with the poses. So I think that works out well. The use of the Black Phantom mask doesn't bug me, the reuse of it doesn't bug me as much here because of the bright colors and bright color scheme, and the introduction of the gold just really makes them look a lot different. Even though it is the same shape on this character here, I'm okay with it. I think it works out pretty well and goes with his personality. The use of the gold on here is a little bit unexpected for going against the lime green, but I think it works out. I think it works great with the figure itself. And then contrasting the green against the purple here is also kind of brave, because there's just a tremendous amount of contrast between those in terms of their colors. But I'm okay with it. I'm always happy to get more purple parts. I know a lot of folks out there are always happy to get things that are not just the basic primary colors. So adding more purple into the Hero Factory world is always a good thing, I think. And all in all, I think that this worked out as a good combination set between a villain character and a vehicle. It's the only vehicle so far in Wave 2. I think it's going to be the only vehicle that they release for it, unless they do a special or limited edition Stormer XL with a bike also, or maybe they'll do kind of an in-between version, like a slightly smaller Stormer XL with a bike that's basically based on this same sort of design. So that's it for my review on this pair. Thank you very much for watching. Please hit either like or thumbs down on the video. Either way helps me out, and I appreciate the feedback. You can always check out all of my current and past reviews on Lego stuff at my blog at hero-factory.blogspot.com, and I also put my mocks up there, as well as links to any videos that may have gotten buried over time. And you can also hit me up on Facebook. You can like my Facebook page for this Lego Jang channel. It's facebook.com/LegoJang. So, for one last time, thanks for watching, and I'll talk to you again soon.